I got my start at the Holiday Inn bars when I was 16 years old. My parents, for some reason, let me go and play every night. I was the kid sitting in the corner with an acoustic guitar, and I would play requests. People would say, play James Taylor, and I'd play James Taylor. Play Harry Chapin, I'd play Harry Chapin. And I wanted to be a songwriter, but at 16, I didn't really have enough experience. So I thought, come graduation, a lot of my friends were going to backpack across Europe. And I thought, well, I'll get paid to do that, and I'll join the U.S. Army. So I had a rucksack across Europe. And I did that for 4 years, and with all this cosmopolitan knowledge that I had now, this worldly knowledge that I had, I went right back to the Holiday Inn and begged for my job back so I didn't have to re-enlist. So I did that for a couple more years, and a friend of mine worked at a country and western radio station, and he asked me if I would like to go meet Willie Nelson. I was like, that sounds like something. So I made a little demo tape, and I went with my friend to go meet Willie at his concert in Kalamazoo, and we got to go up on Willie's bus. And I got to meet Willie and talk to Willie a little bit, and he was very gracious to me. He gave me an autographed picture of himself. I gave him my demo tape. He promised he would listen to it. And I left the bus with this feeling of elation and euphoria. Might have had something to do with the contact buzz from being on Willie's bus. But regardless, Willie called me a few days later, said he'd listened to the demo and he loved it. And he asked if I would want to go play at Farm Aid 4 in Indianapolis. So I went from playing in front of 100 people at the Holiday Inn bar to going down to Indianapolis playing in front of 20, 25,000 people. But I could only play the one song. I'd only written really one good quality song at that point. And I figured, well, I'm gonna have to go back and really buckle down and write some songs now. So I went back to Grand Rapids, Michigan, where I'm from, and I wrote about a dozen songs, and I put together a band to play the songs with my brother Brad, a band called Johnny with an I. And there was another band in town called Water for the Pool. Now, Water for the Pool was the more popular band, and they were the ones that got all the weekend gigs and made all the money, and Johnny with an I, my band, played on Tuesday 25-cent draft beer nights. But the thing is, if you live around colleges, that's the night that all the kids go out, and pretty soon we had amassed quite a following. We borrowed $5,000 and went into a little studio in Grand Rapids, Michigan called Station C Studios. And we recorded our album with a $5,000 budget. And then we went out and we sold that CD out of the trunks of our cars all over the state of Michigan playing these gigs. And we sold about 15,000 copies, which is really good. And then we took some of that money and we went back into Station C Studios again, that little studio, and we recorded another album, and we went out and sold that album, and we sold about 25,000 copies of that album. So the band had only been together for about a year, and already we were making upwards of $200,000-$300,000 of merchandise. Now that got the attention of RCA Records, who signed us to a 4-album deal. Two of the albums were firm, they had to record them and release them, and the other two were their option. If they didn't like the direction the band was going, or they didn't we didn't sell enough records, then they could drop us. At that time, the band had a storage unit out in Lansing, and it was among, 500 storage units, and ours happened to be powered, so we could plug in and play, and we would rehearse at the storage unit with the garage door and the whole thing. At that time, my girlfriend, for what could have been a number of reasons, kicked me out of our apartment, and I moved myself into the storage unit. It was quite disgusting, just a mattress on the floor, no bathroom, no kitchen or anything. But I was gonna roll up my sleeves and I was gonna write music. That's all I was gonna do. And I did that for 10 days. And I wrote some what I thought was great stuff. And I came out of the storage unit. I took a shower. Then I sent the demo tapes out to RCA, and I sent the demos to the band, and RCA got a hold of Jerry Harrison of the Talking Heads, who was a producer, and he loved the demos, and he called me up, and he said, Brian, bring your band out to San Francisco, get RCA to give you enough money to record your debut album out here, your debut major label record. RCA set us up with a budget of $250,000 to go out to San Francisco to record this album, and which is what we did. After a band records an album, what happens is the record label needs about 3 months to set up the record. They're going to go to the radio stations and try to get your single played. They're going to go to MTV and try to get your video played. And while they do that, the band goes out and plays at a bunch of crappy little clubs all across the country trying to get national interest in your band. And we did that for about 3 weeks and, you know, cramming five guys into a hotel room kind of thing. And our manager got the call from the manager of the band Kiss. You know this band. Right now, I was a huge Kiss fan. I was a huge Kiss fan in seventh grade. Kiss had heard an advanced copy of our record and wanted to know if we would want to open up for them. And I thought, wow, this is amazing. Now, some of you, anybody here ever go to a Kiss concert? Ah, we have see a few people. And there's probably more of you that had a Kiss poster in your room. I guarantee you that there's only one person in this room that had the Kiss pillowcases. And my mom let me keep them, even though they gave me a little bit of a rash. Now, I learned a couple of things from this Kiss, opening up for Kiss. First of all, you got to know your audience, okay? Kiss fans would not like our band. We would have been much better off to continue to play these small little places and gaining 50 fans a night instead of playing in front of 20,000 people who did not like us. Because imagine 20,000 people in any given city are anxious to see Kiss. They're going to put the makeup back on. They're going to have, you know, explosions and fire and spit blood and the whole thing. It's going to be awesome. So 20,000 people buy tickets, and then 20,000 people wait for 2 or 3 months to see the show, and then 20,000 people wait outside of an arena for 2 hours, and then they cram 20,000 people inside of an arena for 2 hours. And the lights go down, and 20,000 people roar in anticipation of Kiss, and the lights come up, and it's some stupid band you've never heard of. We were that band. Oh, they were not nice to us at all. It taught me another thing, that I would never fear another crowd. I'm not afraid of you people at all. Well, Valerie, a little bit. Just a little bit afraid of Valerie. So we got through the Kiss tour, and our single went to radio. RCA was working our single. It's a song called Photograph. And it was doing really well. It was like number 22 on the charts. And then that was enough to warrant us going to making a video. And then once the video was played on MTV, it brought the single up to like the top five. And when our album came out, we sold about 150,000 copies of our album pretty quickly. Now that, by any label standards, is a successful record already. Everybody got paid back. The band put a little money in their pocket, that kind of thing. But we had an ace up our sleeve on that record, and that was our song called The Freshman. And I thought I would play that for you today. When I was young, I knew everything. And she, a punk who rarely ever took advice. Now I'm guilt-stricken, sobbing with my head on the floor. Stop a baby's breath and a shoe full of rice. No, can't be held responsible, 'cause she was touching her face. I won't be held responsible. She fell in love in the first place. For the life of me, I cannot remember what made us think that we were wise and we'd never compromise. For the life of me, I cannot believe we'd ever die for these sins. We were merely freshmen. My best friend took a week's vacation to forget her. This girl took a week's worth of Valium and slept, and now he's guilt-stricken, sobbing with his head on the floor. Thinks about her now and how he never really wept, he says. Can't be held responsible, 'cause she was touching her face. I won't be held responsible. She fell in love in the first place. For the life of me, I cannot remember what made us think that we were wise and we'd never compromise. For the life of me, I cannot believe we'd ever die for these sins. We were merely freshmen. Hey, yeah, 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 yeah. Hey, yeah. Hey, yeah, 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 yeah. We try to wash our hands of all of this, and we never talk of our lack in relationships. How we're guilt-stricken, sobbing with our heads on the floor. We fell through the ice when we tried not to slip. We'd say we can't be held responsible, 'cause she was touching her face. I won't be held responsible. She fell in love in the first place. For the life of me, I cannot remember what made us think that we were wise and we never compromise. For the life of me, I cannot believe we'd ever die for these sins. We were merely freshmen. For the life of me, I cannot remember what made us think that we were wise and we never compromised. For the life of me, I cannot believe we'd ever die for these sins. We were merely freshmen. We were merely freshmen. Yeah. I can't understand why the Kiss crowd wouldn't like that song. Yeah, probably because it was about a couple guys that actually went to college. Anyway, that song changed everything for our band. You know, we went from playing clubs to playing theaters, and pretty quickly we sold over a million copies. And the band, at that point, we played Letterman and Leno, but you're only as popular as your next hit song, is what they say in my business. So we had to go out and have another hit song, and we didn't have one on this record, so we had to go record another album. And this time I was going to skip the storage space. I wasn't going to go live in a storage space. I was a world-famous rock and roll star. I was hanging out with Cameron Diaz. What am I going to do? Have my driver drop me off in my storage space and live there for 10 days? No. So I figured out what we were going to do. I asked RCA, I said, let us go record New York City, the greatest city in the world. The energy in the city, the creative atmosphere will inspire. We'll go there, give us the money to do that. And they did. They gave us a budget of $400,000 to record an album in New York City. We're so excited to do that. And we get there, and like a menu in a New York deli, there's too many options, right? Too many things to do in New York, too many distractions. So 3 months to record a record turned into 6 months to record a record, turned into 9 months to record an album. We ended up spending $1.2 million on our follow-up album. Now, put that in perspective. The first album we ever recorded in Grand Rapids, Michigan, $5,000. This was $1.2 million. But it was okay because we were a number one hit songwriting band, and I knew that 1.5 million people had bought our previous album. Definitely 10% of those people at least are going to go out in the first week and buy this follow-up record. My manager said I was crazy. Nobody sells 150,000 copies in 1 week. Lower your expectations. So I said, okay, 5%. 75,000 people will go out, rush right out and buy this new record. First week sales came in, 7,000 people bought the record. It was a huge failure. Tours were canceled. TV shows were canceled. We had a spot on Saturday Night Live, and it was taken away from us. Oh, so terrible. But I didn't know what to do at this point because I was back home. And I had amassed quite a bit of money. I hadn't spent any money because, you know, we were on the road all the time. So I drown my sorrows in spending. I bought a condo just to party in it. I was wine and women and, you know, and all the other vices you can think of and more women and that kind of thing. And suddenly I find myself close to being out of money, and I should have been saving because there was no way that RCA was going to pick up our option. But they did. They offered us $300,000 to go to Chicago and record a new album with a producer who was a young upstart. And they said, you're going to record this album and keep it under budget, and you're going to deliver it on time, or we're going to drop you. So automatically I rolled up my sleeves and I went back and lived in that storage space for 10 days. And I wrote some of the best songs I had ever written. And I came out and I had these songs and I sent them to RCA and I sent them to the producer, and the band loved the songs. RCA flipped. There are 5 singles on this record. It's going to be amazing. Amazing. They take the first single and they go to radio with it, and the radio stations love it. Number 22, With a Bullet, means we're going to make a video. So we're out on the road and we're looking at video treatments and that kind of thing, ready to make a video. And we know that when the video comes out, that song is going to go into the top 5. We knew it. It was another hit for us. And now while we're out on the road trying to regain interest in the band, we get our release date from RCA. Now, the release date is chosen a few months in advance, and we get this release date, and if you look at the date back then, you go, wow, this is great. It's in the fall. Perfect. Back to school. This is a time, you know, where students will go back to college and want new music and talk to other students about music, and Christmas was right around the corner, so you have great retail coming up. But if you look at the date now, you go, wow, the worst fall you could pretend or possibly ever release anything. Our album was released a few short days after 9/11. Now, what do? You don't go out and promote. You can't go out to a radio station and say, hey, you know, tell the people, don't give your money to the Red Cross. Buy our record. It'll make you feel better. You can't do that. Radio stations dropped all of the new songs from their playlists and just started playing classic rock or comfort music, they called it. And so subsequently, that album and our single stalled and died. There was one bright spot in that album, and that was a song I wrote for a movie called Rockstar, called Colorful, and I thought I'd play you a little bit of that. Oh, can you take the vibrato off of the guitar there? Is that possible? Is that coming from me? Is it my natural vibrato? All right, whatever. We'll deal. That's all right. We'll deal with it. It's in the universe somewhere. This is called Colorful. The show is over. Close the storybook. There will be no encore. And all the random hands that I have shook, well, they're reaching for the door. I watch their backs as they leave single file. You stood stubborn, cheering all the while. I know I can be colorful. I know I can be gray. I know this loser's living fortunate. 'Cause I know you will love me the way. Most were being good for goodness sake, but you wouldn't pantomime. Oh, and you are more beautiful when you awake than most are in a lifetime. Oh, but through the haze that is my memory, well, you stayed for drama though you paid for a comedy. I know I can be colorful. I know I can be gray. I know this loser's living fortunate. 'Cause I know
You will love me the way Oh, but look ahead as far as you can see. Well, we'll live in drama, but we'll die in a comedy. And I know I can be colorful. I know I can be gray. I know this loser's living fortunate. I know you will love me, yeah. I know I can be colorful. I know I can be gray. I know this loser's living fortunate, 'cause I know you will love me.
Now, when you have an album coming out and you have a movie coming out at the same time and there's a soundtrack to the movie and a single out and a video, all of the marketing stars align. It's going to be a huge success unless it's the worst terrorist attack on American soil ever. So subsequently, the movie didn't do very well. And RCA decided that they were going to move on and they dropped us. Now, I was out of money. I didn't know what I was going to do. I'd pretty much had it with the industry and the contacts that had helped me out at this point. I knew I would have to do something. So I sold everything that I had, and I bought an old RV, a 1996 Ford Searcher, the kind with a kitchenette in the back and the cab over, the sleeping cab over the, or bunk over the cab. And I was just going to travel with my acoustic guitar and travel around the country and play coffee houses and that kind of thing. And my therapist said that I should go drive to my childhood homes. We moved around a lot when I was a kid. And I should park outside of my childhood homes and I should reflect and meditate and I should do yoga and try not to get arrested for trespassing. I did that for a few weeks and I really came to some spiritual awareness for myself. And this giant box of an RV was now my new storage space, you know. And I wrote some songs that I felt really strongly about. And I decided to go back to that very first studio that the band had recorded in, Station C Studios in Grand Rapids. And I plopped down a little bit of money and I recorded an album called Resurrection. And then I went out and I sold that record across the country, just driving me and my RV. And I sold about 10,000 copies of the record with no help from a video or radio station or anything. And when you don't have a record label taking 90% of what you're selling, 10,000 copies of something is $100,000. So I was putting money in my pocket and my career was back on track and I knew what I had to do. It was just like the old days with the Vert Pipe. I had to take some of that money and make a new album and go out and sell that and perpetuate this life. And it was all going great. And I'm traveling across the country and I met a girl. And I fell in love. And the heart knows no budget. And we wanted to get married, and we wanted a house. And those of you who know Lux know that she probably would not be comfortable raising a family in a storage unit. So pretty soon I realized that I could not only afford to, I couldn't afford to make a new album, I couldn't even afford to pay the mortgage. I got an email from a fan. She said, hey, I was wondering if you'd come play my birthday party. I was like, I don't know, I'm kind of a rock star. I don't know if you heard. I don't know. Where are they going to come to your house and play your birthday party? She wrote back, I'll pay you $2,500. Of course I'll come play your birthday party. Why wouldn't I play your birthday party? You seem like a nice lady. I packed up my acoustic guitar and I drove to her house and And I played her birthday party. I sat in front of her fireplace in her living room with 50 of her family and friends, and it was an amazing experience. I played for them. Everybody paid attention, and somebody yelled out, "Play, you know, Hotel California." I played Hotel California. It's just like those early days of the Holiday Inn. It all came back around full circle. And I left that night with $500 in cash from merchandise sales in one pocket and a check for $2,500 in the other pocket. And I remember thinking to myself, I have 4,000 people on my mailing list. Each one of them has a birthday. That's $10 million. Again, my manager was like, calm down, be more realistic. So what I did was I sent out an email to my family, to my fan base, and I said, look, it's really tough to make it in the music business, and I don't want to go back to the connections that I had, these poisonous connections that I had in my life. So book me into your home. We'll cut out the middleman. Just I'll come and play for your family and friends, and I'll consider any offer, because I didn't want to just play for rich people, so I considered any offer. And within 24 hours, I booked 54 shows. It was amazing. And the next summer that I did it, I booked 108 shows in a four-month period. I would go from one show to the next. I'd do three shows on a Saturday, four shows on a Sunday, and continue on and selling merchandise and gaining fans and making connections while I was out there. Real connections, connections, reconnecting with fans where that wall between the fan and the group is now broke down. And you get to have conversations with people. And you get to stay connected. I'm in my 10th year of the Lawn Chairs and Living Rooms tour. Thank you. I really didn't think I'd make it this far. In fact, my manager really did not like the idea. He was so worried because we go back and forth through email with people. We don't really know people. When I walk up to a door and knock on the door, I typically haven't met the person. No idea. He was worried that I was going to knock on a door. Somebody was going to say there was going to be 50 people there, and it was just one lonely woman. In a wedding dress. But that is yet to happen. I survived what was an emotional crash landing. My music career was all but dead after the RCA experience. And where do you go from there? Do you run back into a burning building to grab your phone and get your old contacts together and that kind of thing? I have a lot of friends who are in 90s bands that still do that. They still pound their head against the major label doors in hopes that will happen, denying the connections that are right in front of them, the people that are there that made them what they are, denying that connection. I had to let all those connections go. I had to let all that baggage go. I carried those connections around with me, those poisonous connections that made me flounder instead of flourish. Where are your connections? Do your connections make you flounder instead of flourish? You know, I realized that I didn't need, you know, do I need the president of RCA? Do I need his home phone number? No, I do not. Do I need Jennifer Aniston's phone number? Yes. But I also have a restraining order against me, so I'm not allowed to contact her. So many connections to be made in positive ways. This is a great community. C3, I've felt it from the first time I walked into the old church at Spring Lake. I felt that connection back in 2007 or 2008 or whatever it was. I feel like this is a terrific group of connected people. And I watch you out in the hallways here when you gather before this actual gathering, and I see people brighten up when you see each other like you haven't seen each other in years. It's so good to see you. It's a wonderful, wonderful community that you have here, and I honor you. I honor you for that. I'm going to leave you with one more song, and I want to tell you one more story about connections if I could. I hope I'm not going too long here. When I was in the Army, I worked on the border of Czechoslovakia and East Germany. I was in military intelligence, and what we did from the German side was my company, and I, we would go out and we'd go to these right up to the border of Czechoslovakia, and I don't mean the border crossing where cars and trucks come across. I mean where you're in the middle of a field and there's nothing but farmland for miles and miles, and it's the middle of the night, and all you have to separate you and the border are these little border stones. They look like gravestones, and they're about 100 yards apart or so, that warn you of it. Now, every once in a while I'm out there in the middle of the night, I would see another soldier on that side, Czechoslovakian soldier. And it was the mirror image of myself. He would have the weapon, and he'd have his uniform, and he'd have the binoculars, and he'd take notes. Like I was taking notes of what he was wearing, and he was taking notes of what I was wearing, but you weren't allowed to make any kind of connection. You weren't even supposed to make eye contact. You certainly couldn't wave or flip anybody off, that's for sure. But I felt like I needed to know, I needed to make a connection with this person because I knew we were connected in some human way. I knew it. So what I did was in the middle of the night, one night I took my pack of cigarettes and I went out to the border stone as stealth as possible, and I put my cigarettes on the border stone. And then I went back 100 yards to my Jeep and I waited, and then 2 hours later, unbeknownst to the rest of my company, a couple hours later, I went out there and the cigarettes were still there. And I was like, okay, well, they didn't accept my gift of cigarettes. I don't know if this is going to work, but I'm going to keep trying it. And I did this many, many times until one day I put my cigarettes out there on the border stone. And I'm walking up to the border stone and I see my cigarettes are still there and I'm really disappointed. And I pick them up and I see that they're Czechoslovakian cigarettes. Right? I made that connection, and it was a quality connection because I have not forgotten that story. I got chills just now telling you that story. That's how important it is to surround your people or yourself with great connections and great people. Like I feel like I'm surrounded today by you. Wonderful. Thank you. I'm going to leave you with one song that I really love. It's not one of mine, but it is. It does have great impact. I need to look at the lyrics too. Sure that I get it right.
Love of mine, someday you will die, but I will be close behind and follow you into the dark. No blinding light or tunnels to gates of white, just our hands clasped so tight, waiting for the hint of a spark. If heaven and hell decide that they both are satisfied, illuminate the nose on their vacancy signs. If there's no one beside you when your soul embarks, I'll follow you into the dark. Catholic school, as vicious as Roman rule, I got my knuckles bruised by a lady in black, and I held my tongue as she told me, son, fear is the heart of love, so I never went back. If heaven and hell decide that they both are satisfied, illuminate the nose on their vacancy signs. If there's no one beside you when your soul embarks, I'll follow you into the dark. You and me have seen everything to see, from Bangkok to Calgary, and the soles of our shoes are all worn down. The time to sleep is now, but it's nothing to cry about, because we'll hold each other soon in the blackest of rooms. If heaven and hell decide that they both are satisfied, illuminate the nose on their vacancy signs. If there's no one beside you when your soul embarks, I'll follow you into the dark. I'll follow you into the dark.
God, love you guys. Thank you so much.